morning and welcome as we gather together on this Mother's Day. And as we gather together on this Sunday, let us prepare our hearts and minds as we go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we express our deep thanks for mothers and mother figures who have shown love and compassion. Empower all mothers and mother figures with courage. Grant them resilience and love in their motherhood, supported by their families and friends, as they nurture their children's growth. Let them find joy in children and wisdom to seek your guidance in their moments of need. Fill their hearts with love and gladness. We lift up all of these things as we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. On this day of celebrating mothers, we remember and lift up our mothers to the Lord. Mothers of young children, first-time mothers, working mothers, and single mothers,
we see you and honor you today.
Grieving mothers who have lost a child too soon and those who desire to be mothers,
we see you and honor you today.
All those who are missing their mothers and mothers who are missing their children,
we see you and honor you today.
Mothers who did not give birth to us biologically, but have raised us and brought life to us in countless other ways,
we see you and honor you today.
In times of full joy and abundance, in times of empty nests and empty cradles, in all these, God tends his flock like a shepherd and carries the lambs close to his heart.
As a mother comforts her child, so will God comfort us.
Today's affirmation of faith is an affirmation from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 6, and Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20. This is the good news which we have received, in which we stand, and by which we are saved. Christ died for our sins, was buried, was raised on the third day, and appeared first to the women, then to Peter and the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Christ, the Anointed One of God, the firstborn of all creation, the firstborn from the dead, in whom all things hold together, in whom the fullness of God was pleased to dwell by the power of the Spirit. Christ is the head of the body, the church, and by the blood of the cross reconciles all things to God. Amen.
Okay, Mom, I got the rest of my tax stuff.
I gotta say, I don't understand any of this.
Don't worry, we'll just go through the forms one at a time.
Thanks, Mom.
Honey, honey!
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
All right, y'all set?
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
You look beautiful, honey. Thanks, Mom.
Thanks, Mom.
Mother's Day. The very special day set aside each year to honor your mother, the best mother who ever lived, the mother of your heart, had its beginning in Grafton, Taylor County, West Virginia. Anna Jarvis dedicated her life to the establishment of Mother's Day, a day which was the inception of her own mother, Anne Reeves Jarvis, calling for someone, somewhere, sometime, to establish a special day for mothers. On the second Sunday in May, 1907, 2 years after the death of Anna Jarvis's mother, she arranged for friends in Grafton to hold a memorial service for her mother. On the same day in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, she invited friends to her home to share her vision of a new national holiday, Mother's Day. She began promoting her idea, and with her persistence, Andrews Methodist Episcopal Church of Grafton launched the annual observance of Mother's Day on Sunday, May 10, 1908. This first official service was held with leadership from Dr. Harry C. Howard, pastor, and Lawson L. Lohr, church school superintendent. During the first Mother's Day celebration held at Andrews Church, carnations, the favorite flower of Anne Reeves Jarvis, mother of the founder and the first honored mother of Mother's Day, were presented to those in attendance, a congregation of 407 persons. The second Sunday of May was proclaimed as Mother's Day as a result of the West Virginia State Proclamation issued on April 26, 1910, by West Virginia Governor William E. Glasgow. On May 8, 1914, the United States Congress, by adoption of a joint resolution endorsing the observance of Mother's Day, authorized the President to proclaim Mother's Day to be celebrated on the second Sunday of each May as a national holiday, celebrating the public expression of our love and reverence for the mothers of our country. The resolution was officially approved on May 9, 1914 by President Woodrow Wilson, making Mother's Day official nationwide. On May 15, 1962, the magnificent Andrews Church, built in 1873, was declared to be the International Mother's Day Shrine. Everlasting as an international shrine to all mothers and as a memorial to Anna Jarvis, founder of Mother's Day. Today, the Andrews Church congregation is part of the Church of the Good Shepherd United Methodist of Grafton, the combined Andrews, St. Paul's, West Main Street, and St. John's churches.
At this time, as we gather together, let us take a few moments and to remember names and situations that we lift up with our joys and concerns, and we will have a brief moment of silent prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today's reading comes from the Gospel of John in chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. When Judas was gone, Jesus said, "Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now. Where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." On this Mother's Day, we speak about Christ like love, about the kind of love mothers and fathers have, and each one of us are called to have, and by the grace of God, do have, should we in fact be following in his steps through faith. What is the greatest commandment? Jesus is asked, and he replies, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul, strength and mind, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself." A rabbi, writing about the second of these laws as it is found in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, tells a story that goes like this. A Russian peasant farmer who never left the small surroundings of his town had occasion to come to the big city of Moscow. He arrived at the elegant hotel with mud on his boots and overalls, looking completely inappropriate. The man at the desk assigned him to a room on the top floor and treated him as any other paying customer. With key in hand and a few possessions, he started the long climb to the hotel room. On the first floor, there was a full-length mirror. The man, who had never seen himself before, was suddenly startled and frightened by the imposing image before him. He growled and barked to scare him away, only to find that the image in the mirror was willing to threaten and shout the same. He ran to the next floor and confronted the fearsome giant again exchanging harsh looks and almost coming to blows. On the third floor, they stood nose to nose and exchanged simultaneous insults as a deepening warlike attitude was taking root in both of them. Realizing that there was nowhere to escape this ugly, beast-like person who was stalking him in the hotel, he ran back down to the lobby and to the front desk to file a complaint. After having given a detailed description of the perpetrator, the man at the desk understood that he had met the enemy, and it was the man in the mirror. So, as to save the face of his guest and to stop the hostility, he offered simple advice. He said, "The person you confronted is here to protect people. He is really quite harmless. Trust me, if you will show him a harsh and angry countenance, he will do the same. However, if when you see him, you just smile and continue on your way, he will nod and smile at you as well. Now, go and enjoy the rest of your stay." That's what he did. And to his surprise, that's what happened. King Solomon is reported to have once said, "Like the reflection of a face in water, so is the heart of one person to another." To really love another, we often need a standard or guide to follow, and within that standard or guide, we need help. Help to not only know what love is, but to know that the love we need is within us, that it is embracing us and has the power to embrace others through us, especially to embrace those others towards who we do not feel love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul, strength and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And to that law, which can be most difficult for us to keep, Jesus added one more. "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another." A story is told about a mother who was helping one of her children put his boots on. He asked for help, and she could see why. With her pulling and him pushing, the boots still didn't want to go on. And when the second boot was on, she had worked up a sweat. She almost whimpered when her son said, "Mommy, they're on the wrong feet." She looked, and sure enough, they were. It wasn't any easier pulling the boots off than it was putting them on. She managed to keep her cool as together they worked to get the boots back on, this time on the right feet. He then announced, "These aren't my boots." She bit her tongue instead of getting in his face and screaming, "Why didn't you say so?" like she wanted to. Once again, she struggled to help him pull the ill-fitting boots off. He then said, "They're my brother's boots." She didn't know if she should laugh or cry. She mustered up the grace to wrestle the boots on his feet once again. She said, "Now, where are your mittens?" And he said, "I stuffed them in the toes of my boots." Ever have one of those days? I think all of us do. The question is, will we bite our tongues and do that good thing we desire to do? Will we face the countless little crosses that appear before us each day? Will we willingly take on the burdens that should not be ours to take, despite a lack of appreciation and understanding among those whom we are helping? This is what love does. It accepts the little crosses, knowing that the large cross has already been taken care of for us. Knowing that because Jesus has accepted us, so we can accept others in his love, that we can trust them into his care, his judgment, his mercy, and his righteousness. Love one another as I have loved you. This means be open to the new and to that which was previously impossible for us to be open to. For us, that may mean to be open to those that are wisdom, and our feelings tell us to be unclean and unholy, unacceptable and undesirable. For some, that may be someone who has hurt us beyond words. For others, it may be the nameless panhandlers who beg at our doors, or the sinners who enter into our homes to steal not only physical treasures, but to rob the entire human family of its joy and hope. For some, it may be an employer, a debtor, or some group of persons that have done us or our world an injury. Love one another as I have loved you. God loves us most powerfully and gives us the power to love others. Would we love someone today that we find it hard to love? Then know that God loves us without condition and will make our life full and abundant as we turn to love others with God's love. A grandma and her grandson, whose face was sprinkled with bright freckles, spent the day at the zoo. Lots of children were waiting in line to get their cheeks painted by a local artist who was decorating them with tiger paws. "You've got so many freckles, there's no place to paint," a girl in line said to the little boy. His grandmother knelt down next to him. "I love your freckles. When I was a little girl, I always wanted freckles," she said, while tracing her finger across the child's cheek. "Freckles are beautiful." The boy looked up. "Really?" "Of course," said the grandmother. "Why, just name me one thing that's more beautiful than freckles." The little boy thought for a moment, looked intensely into his grandma's face, and softly whispered, "Wrinkles." May all our friends and all those who would be our enemies if we let them be, have beautiful freckles and wrinkles. Let go and let God and love one another as Christ loves us, with a love that saves and redeems his people. Blessed be God's name day by day. Amen. Thank you for joining us today, and as we get ready to go our separate ways and begin a new week, let us go to God in prayer. Today, brothers and sisters, may the Lord who brought us to birth by his Spirit strengthen us for the Christian life. May the Lord, who provides for all our needs, sustain us day by day. May the Lord, whose steadfast love is constant as a mother's care, send us out to live and work for others, and the blessing of God Almighty. Amen.